exactly what I wanted to do, and it was just such a laugh. You know, every second of the studio time was in between things. You would crack a joke, or you would do something on a bazooka, or you'd be guilty, or you would eat an apple in a funny way, and you would love it. You know? So it was a very special person in my life. Taught me a lot musically. I think more than anyone I've ever worked with, Sugar was the man who really made me discipline myself to understand that writing songs is very different from writing poetry. Because as a poet, you think, I do what I want. I want to put 15 words on a line. I'll put 15 words on a line, all right? What's it bother you about, you know, how I write my lyrics? And he said to me, yeah, but when you put that to music, you've got to follow a beat. You've got one, two, three, four, one, two, three, four. And so all of a sudden, I started thinking about things differently. I'll never forget, when we was writing this song, we were going to a studio called Swanyard, which I had a publishing deal with. And the way it worked was you would go to Sugar Studio, do all the programming for the song, and then the next day you'd go and record it, and record the vocals, and the bazooki, and all the other instruments, all the live instruments. And he would program it all on his computer, the beat and the various things, and we'd go the next day. 2 o'clock in the morning, his studio was in his house in Edmonton. My flat was in Hackney. 2 o'clock in the morning, I was out there, going home. Where are you going, mate? Where are you? I said to him, finish the song, you've done the program. You've got two jam here, eh? I'm going to work on the lyrics. I said, what are you talking about? We're going to work on the lyrics. My lyrics, finish them. The call is finished. God said, I'm in a grapsis, he goes to me. So we sat there for about another 2-3 hours. And he really made Vragaman what it was. I must say, without those 2-3 hours, that song wouldn't have possibly even got, you know, 1/10 of the way it went. And that song, along with the one before it, Stavrula, went completely ballistic. Firstly, in the community, with the support of Grehandiri and the DJs that played the weddings, because they were playing it, and the local media, with the exception of again, who were very supportive at that time. The local media, we had radio stations, and we had later on, I think, it was LMET, a TV station. They found it a little bit too controversial, based on Greek. Israeli, he's black music. And they were a little bit strange about it. And I even got a really dodgy message on my answer phone from an annoyed Greek Cypriot saying, why don't you do this music, man? And I came up to them after the wine festival when I sang it. It was really weird, because on the one hand, you had all these people really getting into it, especially the DJs. And there were some really conservative people who were thinking, I'm destroying things. And then he went to Cyprus, and literally, my friend Jimmy was there at the time. He was from another side, and he lived through all that. And it was a very shocking experience for me. I never really intended to be famous. I just wanted to write music. I didn't want to walk down the street and always go, oh, how do you like it? You know, like 300 people chasing after me. Feeling boys or something when I played the Gadakis Wine Festival. That was complete, you know, I don't know, it just reminded me of E17 or something. A little bit. That's not what I want to be, you know. It's quite the song, and I love the song, and I still perform it, but it was very weird in a way. One of the funniest experiences I had with this song was singing it in Dublin at the time to 300 Irish people in a world music club. I think it was called Club Juju. And I got invited to play there by a group of people there. I had to rewind it 3 times for them. It was like, you have to do it again, you have to do, you know, do that intro again. And I just found it in the way music travelled like that. 300 people, none of whom understood a single word I was saying here. Because it's kind of like, in Greenwich mainly, with a few Jamaican words thrown in. And they just loved the beat, they loved the music. And I quite enjoyed myself like that, you know, with this song. Travelling all over the world with it, and watching people, giving people in Cyprus something Cypriot to be proud of, and giving British Cypriots something Cypriot to be proud of. It was very important for me, and it still is, that to where it got to. Sugar was important in the making, but these guys were really important in the way they helped promote it. They didn't simply say to me, oh, it's, you know, well, it's not great. The funny thing with the Kandiri, right, Lagi and Agi were the best quality control you could ever imagine. I did four songs before this, and every time I go there, it's like, nah. You know, now it's like getting, well, yeah, well, I can see what you're going with. But this particular song and stuff, don't know, it's alright, you know. Thinking, number where's Agi? It's alright, you know. It was kind of like strange getting that from a person who played kind of very creative Greek heavy metal music, you know. Great guitarist and a fantastic human being. I'm going to do a song for him, but he's featured in after this. Vragaman is unfortunately, is the song I'm associated with. Every artist has a song that everyone knows. And I go around media and stuff, radio stations, and, you know. I remember I came 10 years ago, Mario was with me when we went to LGR. I think I said then. We went to LGR, and I don't really do a lot of interviews in London. And they eventually said, yeah, all right, come by. And I did a 10-minute interview. And the guy played it. His name will remain anonymous between me and Chuck was. And we went there, and he played Vragaman off YouTube, and it froze on air. Strange experience. I didn't even have the record or the CD. And I went there to promote a brand new album, which was actually one of the ones up there. I think it was around about the time of probably Virtual Oasis. I wanted to talk about an amazing album I did with Doug Caravan. And I went into this interview, and that's all he played, and that was it. And it was a bit demeaning in a way. Although I loved the song, I wasn't happy about the fact it was. Not saying that though, this week I did a fantastic interview with Camille Glells on LGR, which was about 45. She was a really good interviewer, and I was really pleased that someone finally knows how to do interviews on radio and does them extremely well. But Vragaman, there's a lot of stories I could say about, I could talk about it all night. I'm not going to talk about it anymore, I'm going to do it. Just, you know, if you want to get up and dance, you're fully welcome. Just don't do it standing upside down. And in love.